What is going on at the EPA after internal documents suggest a concerted effort to bury a report that questions the science on global warming? Now Congress is calling for an investigation.
In June of 2009, a story surfaced about the alleged suppression by the US EPA of information related to climate change. The source of the information was reported to be one Dr. Alan Carlin, who, although a real EPA analyst, was in fact an economist, not a scientist.
Not that there's anything wrong with that.
Distortions of the story from the usual sources began almost immediately.
Most of us are not scientists. You are.
Though not a scientist and not part of the working group for this topic, Dr. Carlin had, it seems, produced a document that soon became available on the internet. The question observers were asking is, since Dr. Carlin had done no original research on climate, what his resources for information were. Certain parts of the report sounded remarkably similar to material from unpeer-reviewed climate denial websites like this one. In fact, sharp-eyed reviewers soon picked up passages from this website that were not only similar, but in some cases nearly identical to parts of the report. On the left, you can see a paragraph from the World Climate Report website, and on the right, you can see a section of Dr. Carlin's paper. The highlighted areas in Carlin's paper are those that appear to be cut and pasted almost exactly from the web to the so-called scientific study. So it would appear that Dr. Carlin submitted for consideration as part of an official technical recommendation a cut-and-paste job that would have earned him a failing grade in freshman earth science class.
Not that there's anything wrong with that.
Not at all.
But setting that aside, what about the allegation that the passage makes? The argument is this.
Now, all of this debate on global warming and cap and tax is based upon the UN Climate Change Commission's findings, which were released about 3 years ago. And if these findings are off, then all of the arguments that were made in support of the cap and tax bill that passed last Friday in the House of Representatives are not based on scientific efforts.
Is that true? Has research on climate stopped? Has the information become dated and obsolete? In fact, science is ongoing, and signals are increasingly alarming. In 2009, an interdisciplinary group at MIT completed a review of climate science, updating an earlier report from 2003. Based on the newest data, climate predictions have become significantly more dire, with projected temperature changes much higher than found in earlier studies. In addition, the MIT group found that due to the Earth's decreasing ability to absorb carbon emissions, CO2 levels could be much higher than predicted just a few years ago. Based on this research, the MIT group now writes that the question is no longer whether global warming is upon us, but how we can rise to the challenge. Responding to the same research, the head of Stanford University's Department of Global Ecology recently said, "We are basically looking at a future climate that's beyond anything we've considered seriously in climate model simulations." But what about some of the other points of Dr. Carlin's paper?
Well, and a scientific point of view that we don't hear much these days about the globe is cooling? Who knew?
The paper does indeed include a number of temperature graphs. These, in fact, appear to be lifted directly again from the same denialist website, and they follow a familiar deceptive formula. A time-honored way to mislead with graphs is known as the cherry pick. In this case, selecting a slice of time that appears to support a predetermined reading of the data. Climate change is measured in decades, but Carlin has chosen graphs that begin in 2006. There's a reason for this, well known to climate scientists. 2007 was the peak of an El Nino event in the Pacific Ocean. which releases enormous amounts of heat to the atmosphere and causes warmer global conditions. Since then, the Pacific has moved into a La Niña, a temporary cooling phase. It's also worth noting the particular data sets that these graphs refer to. In this graph, one of the lines is labeled CRU Surface Observations. CRU refers to the Climatic Research Unit at the University of East Anglia in the UK. This is the primary data resource for the British Meteorological Office, one of the most respected climate centers. The Met Office is very clear what their data actually shows. Temperatures are continuing to rise. In 2008, the Met Office published a document meant for the layman entitled Global Warming Goes On. The front page includes a summation of the science in very plain English. The paper also illustrated the cherry-picking technique, pointing out that by choosing short timescales and the right start year, dishonest people can attempt to show almost any climate trend they wish. The other database referenced in Dr. Carlin's graph is labeled UAH Satellite Observations. UAH refers to the University of Alabama at Huntsville, which is home to yet another widely used temperature database. One of the key scientists behind this data is Dr. John Christie. Dr. Christie is widely known in climate science circles as a contrarian, one of the small minority of working climatologists who does not believe that climate change will be a catastrophic problem. No one would call Dr. Christie a global warming alarmist, but he knows what his data says, and he stated as much in February of 2009.
I am writing the American Meteorological Society's report on upper air temperatures. I have 7 data sets in there. Turns out they're all very, very close together. So the planet is warming about 0.14 degrees C per decade right now.
So Dr. Carlin has presented data purporting to show global cooling, an interpretation directly at odds with the opinion of the very scientists whose data he is using.
Not that there's anything wrong with that!
No, not at all.
So what we have here is a frustrated bureaucrat who indulges his hobby of cruising the web on taxpayer time, produces a plagiarized document on a subject outside his expertise, and is told, thank you, now go back to work. But Dr. Carlin is merely a prop in this drama. He states he is not the source that leaked his document to the media. According to reports, the internal EPA documents came through a Washington think tank known as the Competitive Enterprise Institute, an ultra-conservative organization, the recipient of massive funding from, among others, Exxon, and best known for a series of television ads touting the benefits of carbon dioxide.
Carbon dioxide. They call it pollution. We call it life.
Aaron Ebel, why do you imagine that Exxon give you money?
I think that the attempt here to claim that only the purest of the pure can engage in the public policy.
Please answer the question, Mr. Ebel. Why do you imagine they give you money?
Because we send them letters asking for money to support our general programs, which is our general program is simply this. We believe in free markets, and we support policies to promote less regulation of people's daily lives.
And they would presumably not be giving you that money if they felt that you were taking a different view, for example, on climate change.
I suppose that's right.
Pull the string and out we go.